All right, and welcome to Wednesday, everybody. We are live with the Voice of Humanity here at UCY.TV, and I'm just so happy to be here with this network. Start out with love and shouts to Jules and Paul for keeping the network so spiffy all the time. It's getting better and better. My guest from last week, Thomas Ford, who brought us some pretty urgent information that you probably didn't know in relation to the New Madrid Zone and the actual cause, or what he believes to be the cause of that. We did have a little technical difficulty getting links, but those have been put out on YouTube. We can get you a link to that information. If you haven't seen it, just drop a note in the chat room. And alongside Thomas, his partner and researcher, Kate, to make sure things go smoothly, and a backup PC, so if anybody thinks they're going to stop Thomas tonight, they will fail. And next to him on Skype with me, it's an honor to also have Jim Resonated Lee, who is just an amazing go-getter in relation to climate change and all the stuff he's done with his website. And we'll also have another call-in from one of Thomas' constituents and researchers here in a little while. Gentlemen, welcome to the show. Everybody's connected, I suspect.
We are.
That's awesome. Hello Thomas. And you guys just overwhelm me with your knowledge of all this stuff, so I'm just going to hand it over to you and try to stay the hell out of your way, because I know you got a lot of information for everybody. If there's any problem relaying links, I know Resonated, I saw you in the chat room. I don't know, Thomas, if you've made it in there yet, but if you need help relaying links, just drop them below. And, I don't know where you guys want to pick up. I know Jim's got some exciting stuff going on, but Thomas, I'll hand it over to you and take it away.
Thank you. I want to say first, our hearts are with all of the victims of Moore, Oklahoma, and their families, and all of the families and folks devastated by the tornado outbreaks Monday.
Yeah, definitely.
Thank you, Jim, for being here, and thank you, Kevin and Jules and UCI Radio for having me and Mr. Jim Resonated Lee. It's an honor. I'm truly blessed. It's my honor, brother. I can't thank you enough. We're just going to cover the full scope. These are planned mega disasters. We're going to look at the who, what, when, and why. We're going to look at the suppression of information. We're going to look at the current trends that are ongoing. We'll cover the floods that occurred in 2011 from Canada to the Gulf, the levee bombings in New Madrid at the Bird's Point levee. We're going to cover all the cover-ups that our U.S. government and other world governments are adamantly involved in to keep all of this information from getting to you, the public. Mr. Jim Lee has been working adamantly to get this information that must be disclosed to all, and his videos are disappearing. There's a treasure trove of information which I'm going to be fully endorsing and educating people as best to my knowledge, and using these wonderful programs he's put together for us to monitor our world and see the reality for what it is. Anybody have anything they'd like to add before we really kick off, or where should we begin?
I'm your guest. I'm here at your behest. And any questions, if you want me to enlighten on any kind of topics, I'll be glad to do that. And if I think we get a little too far off the track, I will definitely say so.
Perfect. Well, we're going to keep it on focus, brother. I guess the best thing I can say is thank you so much for adding the Fireball Watch to your beautiful Climate Viewer 3D. That is so important because we're covering the suppression of history. If the meteor did in fact impact there in northern Mississippi and the governments are watching and monitoring for more celestial bodies to fall, we need to be aware and monitoring the situation. The potential threat to the New Madrid could come from any celestial body slamming into any part of any continent. And there's many other fault lines that are capable of also receiving extreme earthquake, and just it's going to be global potential disaster. And we don't want information to be suppressed, and we don't want to see anybody in harm's way. So it's about warning folks and just being aware of our realities. So when Tony comes on, hopefully we can get Climate Viewer 3D fired up and check out this Fireball Watch in action.
Real quick before we get any further, you know, two things come to mind. I know that recently there was a discussion about classifying near-Earth misses of comets and stuff. Have either of you heard about that?
Negative.
All right, I'll find the link before the show's over. And also, I've got this new system that I'm working on. It's on the front page of climateviewer.com. Tattoo and Dutchson's just did a video trying to, you know, help me get the word out about it. If anybody wants to help support, there are links there. But what the system is going to do is allow us to tie sensors in. So hopefully the long-term goal is that you guys out there that want to have all sky cameras, dual purpose, there are the Fireball guys, there's the UFO guys, there's the chemtrail guys. We could literally put all sky cameras all across America and tie them into our system and have it live 24 hours a day. We just got to make it happen. This is the next version of Climate Viewer I'm working on, and you know we'll be able to work in things like that. But right now, currently, there are webcam scouring applications out there that you can look for, and you can, you know, find webcams near the town where one was spotted, and sometimes you can get lucky. But that's about all we got right now.
Well, we're not going to keep the good luck to ourselves, and thank you again for dedicating your life and keeping these wonderful programs evolving at such an enormous accelerating rate. It's just near impossible to keep up with the rate of information and everything happening, but with your programs, it really takes a big load off.
Yeah, I think that there are so many sensors out there. They've all got their own little kingdom, and people worship them, and they go there daily. But in the end, it really doesn't do us any good when it takes you 30 minutes just to do your daily routine to find out what the heck is going on. And, you know, I learned from experience with my activism on my WordPress blog that people have a attention span of about 2 minutes and 30 seconds. If you add images in, you get about 6 minutes out of them. And then on average, you know, I've got all these videos on YouTube. Generally speaking, people get about 5 minutes through a video before they decide they need to go check their football score. So, you know, we got a lot of work ahead of us to try to get something that really brings all of these into a central location so that you can real quickly have what's called situational awareness. This is what the military loves. I think that the average man should have situational awareness, you know, this plus this equals I probably shouldn't go there. And, you know, it's something to be worked on. I'm working on it.
Well, we're all in this together, and you work so smart and hard. And I'm so thankful to see that we have supporters. And this is going to come – this is what we all need so we can keep the cover-ups from happening. And there's ways we can keep the censorship from – these videos from disappearing and all this information, more and more are going to be teaming up, and this information will be common knowledge. So we can cover more of these disasters wherever they occur, however they occur, and figure out if there's any nefarious activities behind them so we can give the future generations a world worth inheriting.
Hey, you guys, you're both reasonable men, so I do have a quick question. As far as this censorship, when we're talking about naturally occurring events, whether they're catastrophic or not, what is the reasoning, the logic to hide that from people? And I know everybody throws the panic bomb out there. Oh, most people will panic, but I don't believe that. I think that they don't let us know because if we knew then and we were informed, then we would prepare and our investments would be in places that they wouldn't have a hold on our money, so to speak. But am I reading too much into it, or do you really think that people would lose their minds if they knew a comet was coming and it was going to strike the Earth and all these things? I mean, everybody's so sedated. I don't see how they could overreact now.
I think that that is exactly why they overreact. I think that the average individual, you know, if you looked at their electrical current, it would barely fluctuate. And then the minute they're given any kind of stimulus, they overreact. An example from I'm in South Carolina. A common example is if it snows in South Carolina, within 24 hours, you cannot go to a Piggly Wiggly and find any food. And that is snow.
I've never been big on that, you know. That's why I got so pissed off at the whole Fukushima thing, because it's just, we could do things to protect ourselves. We're reasonable people, aren't we? Maybe we're not. You do see a lot, especially Jim, like you being a fellow YouTuber, you see all likes of miscreants, let's say.
To be clear though, I fully agree with you that it, you know, I want to know the truth and be able to afford it. So give it to me straight and I'll deal with it. But you know, there's this babysitter mentality in the government that says, you know, oh, you can't handle this. Oh, we should make you do this because this will be good for you. I don't ascribe to that kind of stuff, but most people have relied on it that way. I mean, used to, the parents took care of the kids and they taught them everything. And now, you know, it's like let the school do that. Let the TV do that. So there's no personal responsibility and people are all, you know, reactionary robots. It's really, really sad. But in most cases, if we lose power downtown, you know, people always say the martial law is a scary thing. Oh, there's going to be martial law in America. And I say to that, martial law is declared in America on average 30 to 100 times. You know, I'm throwing that number out there, but you can go look it up. Just on average, there's plenty of martial law declared. Usually it's the National Guard rolling into town because a hurricane just flattened the place. Right now in that town where Oklahoma, I'm sure there's martial law because, you know, there's martial law there right now because it's flattened. There's no security. People are homeless, desperate. If you just lost your house, you lost your wife, your children, you have no place to eat tonight, you don't know what you would do, and you've never been in that place. So I don't rush to judge. I just try to keep a level head about everything. And you know, it's not that surprising that they act that way, and I agree that it's completely wrong.
Gentlemen, we did have a caller join us. I'm assuming, Thomas, this is your guest from area code 901.
That's Tony Hood. That's Caleb Penn's Legacy.
Yes, sir. Hello. Yes, sir. Hello. Hello.
Howdy. Welcome, Tony. Welcome. Can you hear us?
Thank you for having me.
It's a pleasure.
Yeah, I just want to say a few things, I guess. I don't believe most understand how fortunate this planet has been concerning impact events. What occurred in 1911 is nothing new, and it's happened many times and at different degrees and different scales. These are unchanging events, as catastrophes such as this have shaped history, destroyed and brought in new life, and have drastically changed the geology of the planet on a rather regular basis. It is my belief that even before the Great Comet of 1811 was seen by Copernicus in March, its effects were already being felt. And the comets, if they are large enough, with enough mass, having enough velocity, and under the right trajectory and alignment, and are close to the Earth, they can push pressure waves full of charged particles and cosmic rays directly towards the planet, producing strange weather patterns and vibrations between tectonic plates, and this causes earthquakes.
I'm actually familiar with what you're talking about. You talking about Dr. Mansour Omer Bashish, the geo-resonator theory?
There's been various studies into this. Dr. Mike Bailey has also done, he's a dendrochronologist. He's also done work with tree rings and the study of comets when they pass and the detrimental effects to the environment. And a lot of times they all coincide exactly, the problems with the environment and the passing of close comets, large comets anyway. And this was a global catastrophe, you know. This was from a serial impact off the tail of C-1811F1. It was a sun grazer, and as it passed, the outer shell broke apart, you know, producing a massive dust tail. And as it slingshots out at a much higher rate, you know, speed, you know, it's sending it traveling out. It just in front of Earth, and as it passed the planet, revolved through the dust tail, you know, for over a month. Several meteors impacted, and one of them was large enough to cause it, the events of New Madrid earthquakes of 1811, 1812.
Cool.
There's a lot to look at. There's a lot to study, yes, sir. It just pushed massive amounts of land northward, and it's easy to see it on any satellite view. And you can see it, actually, you can see the Mississippi embayment from space. Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, my name's Bill Key. I'm just new to your thing here on the internet. I'm an avid follower of Resonate and Radchick and Jim and Dutch Sense, and I happen to believe that a lot of what they're doing is absolutely true, and there are other entities that don't want this information out.
Yes, sir. I've run into several problems, and I've been trying to put this out for the last 4 or 5 years pretty strong now, and it should have been easy, I believe, but I don't know. As far as how obvious it is, I mean, I guess I can explain the satellite view, the topography to you. It's if you go to the satellite view, you put the upper embayment in view, and you draw an imaginary line down the middle of the New Major Bend, straight to where I found the rocks in North Slayton, Mississippi. Then you'll notice the lines in the terrain. They'll show you the angle and direction and the force of the impact. And if you follow each river to the north, the Wolf, the Hatchie, the Loosahatchee, down each of their valleys to view the, you can see the larger wave from the shock that extends all the way from the Tennessee River on the east around past the St. Francis River on the west. And you'll see all the semicircular fractures and sand blows, they all point directly to the structure. The man-made lake to the south, Enid, Sardis, and Archibald, they're all where the land was split apart and pulled upward by the blast. And then later these chasms created the lakes, you know, so... You know, every river, lake, valley, and every detail in topography surrounds and points directly to the same central location. So I'm not sure, you know, what their argument would be.
I'd like to add something to this, without a doubt.
Yes, sir.
Originally, you were talking about the georesonator theory. And I just want to clarify for, you know, some of the audience some of these terms, because these are really big terms. And also offer you some insights maybe you've never heard of.
Okay.
The hyperresonator theory came from Dr. Omer Bashish. His name is Mensur Omer Bashish. He claims to be the crown prince of Croatia. He wrote a Cornell University paper that described the comet Elenin aligning with two other astrological bodies, causing the hyperresonator effect, which caused earthquakes magnitude 6 or greater on Earth.
I have to reiterate that actually he did improve on Nikola Tesla's design of the also thermoacoustic refrigeration, and Tesla had telegeodynamics. And it's a very low frequency, high intensity sound pressure. Well, that's what
it's called the Schumann resonance.
Yes, sir. It's the same. It works on resonance, the same as it's a very low frequency. This is what thermoacoustic refrigeration works on, very low frequency, high intensity pressure within a vacuum, and it produces very cold temperatures.
Let's try to keep it a little more general for some of the audience, and I want to just shoot some ideas out there. The earliest forms of this that I've ever heard of dates back to the Sumerians, the Babylonians. It's called the music of the spheres. And the music of the spheres described the vibrations that are shared between celestial bodies. I fully believe this is a sound theory. It's carried through to the Renaissance period, where it was reintroduced as Musica Universalis, something like that. I may be butchering it, but it was essentially the same thing, universal music. And these are just about harmonious tones that are exchanged between bodies and how they share energy and exchange energy, because, you know, can't be created or destroyed, so it's got to go somewhere.
That's what our orchestras are based on. The Egyptians kept up the same thing with the resonance, and they had the music too.
All those resonant tones that they came up with way back in the day, you're right. So, and then we flash forward to Omer Bashish. He writes a paper that says dire scientific predictions can cause riots in the real world. Look it up. It's a fact. Then 2 years later, he writes a paper saying that there's a comet coming and it's causing earthquakes. And by the way, it caused earthquakes back to 1960, when in fact that 1960 earthquake, the Rat Island, when he's referring to, was a nuclear explosion. Go look it up. So he's
there's all kinds of things that cause earthquakes, and you got to watch out what you're saying. That's true. And I'm not into fear mongering or putting out fear or anything, But I would like people to know, you know, the effects of close comet, you know. So,
yeah.
The cometary effects can be a severe thing. And that's all through the ages, they've all known that what comets can cause. And, you know, so, I mean.
Well, I'm going to drop Omer Bashish's website into chat. He still kept it up to this day where he monitors the mass resonance magnification and earthquake changes. He's been running a chart for quite some time. The other theory out there is called Jupiter's Dance. I don't know if you've heard of this one. I'm going to put it up to his jupitersdance.com for those listening. This guy basically says research shows that large earthquakes occur at low sunspot frequencies. Now, for those that don't know, imagine a tornado, a little, if you've ever seen a magnet and you lay it on the table, there's these bows that, you know, form around the poles of the magnet. There are these poles that come from the top of the sun to the top of our planet, and then out the bottom of our planet and back to the sun. So there's a loop there. There's an exchange of energy occurring at all times there. Now, this Jupiter's Dance is saying that when there are very few sunspots, there are more earthquakes. People should look into it. It's a theory. I haven't, you know, done it myself. Yeah. But if you're into this sort of thing, you might want to consider it.
Well, it's the vibration of the whole solar system. That's why we skipped a year between going through several comets. And in 2011, we had a comet swarm with the Olenin and several other comets that impacted the sun and caused CME bursts. Several bursts out the other side, the opposite side where the comet hit. And, the comet Olenin was one that had enough mass. If it had been on the right trajectory and if it had been made it around the sun, it might have caused a lot of problems. But now we got another, there were a couple other comets, and now I believe Comet Ison is predicted to come out and be as bright as the full moon. So I don't know if it's going to have a similar effect, but if it has enough mass, you know, and it's on the right trajectory, then I believe that, you know, it could cause some of these similar effects.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm not sure, but it's just a possibility, I believe. Everybody must talk about how, you know, beautiful the comets are, and they are, but there's a lot of, you know, throughout the ages, they've talked about how they can cause severe environmental downturns also. So I don't know if you're familiar with any of Mike Bailey's work, but he has studied this for several years, and the tree rings pretty much tell the story of the past and the alignment with the large comets and wars and plagues and all that all goes in with the comets. I'm not sure, you know, if
I just wanted to jump in real quick. I just got a note from my mother showing me that the ice ring cores and the tree rings are the same, so it concurs with this theory.
Okay.
Just wanted to hop in there real quick.
That's the same Professor Mike Bailey? That's a different one.
I'll have to check the link. I will provide it when possible. I also wanted to briefly mention can you cover kind of what happened with your specialist from the USGS and all the strife, and, you know, kind of explain what happened with the universities and just kind of give some details as to how this information is apparently, people don't want this going out. People in high places, the upper echelons, are doing everything in their power to keep all this suppressed. Matter of fact, all those emails you sent me, I didn't get a one.
I don't understand all that and why that's happening, because there's so much evidence that points directly to this impact, and they can't cover it up, and they keep teaching false just nonsense in school to the children. I mean, you know, there were two volcanoes in the middle of Mississippi, and one of them was named Midnight, and the other one was named Burning Mountain. Well, the one Burning Mountain now is called the Jackson Dome, and it's directly underneath the Jackson Coliseum. Well, they have all these stories and all kinds of legends behind them, and one of the last ones was a guy met him in Natchez, and the Indians said that Burning Mountain had been rent to its base, and this is during the New Madrid events. Well, they dated the volcanoes. They're buried now 2,900 feet below the city, and they dated them as being buried in the Cretaceous period 65 million years ago. Well, I mean, they come out and they tell you that these volcanoes have all these stories, and they got they got nicknames, and then they try to say, well, that they were buried in the Cretaceous period 65 million years ago. It's very confusing. So, I mean, to tell you the truth, after finding out about this impact and everything, the geology of the entire state of Mississippi has been falsified. So what we need to do is go back and look at all these structures and all these places and redate and see what we did wrong with the dating process. Because what they did was, as far as the petrified forest in Mississippi, they dated the sand and they dated the outer side, and to me, I believe they dated the outer core of the comet. And see, that's when it came down, so I'm not sure, you know, what we can do. Like I said, the Killmichael structure, they dated it way back in the past, and there's no way that none of this could be any older than 200 years that this impact actually occurred. So that's what I want to try to see, if I can find all the complex geological data, if I can find someone to get a LIDAR done, you know, and get some core samples, and, you know, check for iridium and shock quartz and, you know, all that. So, you know, I need spectrometers and microscopes and people, you know, to get on this and see if that's what really occurs. So this is important to our past. It changes a lot of our history. So this is very important to understand that, you know, a lot of our history has been changed from this occurrence, and it went unnoticed. So I'm trying to get it out there, and I sure do appreciate y'all's help with getting this news out there. Anyway, go ahead.
Thank you for stepping up, and thanks for joining in, man.
You're breaking up. I'm sorry, I'm on this old cell phone. But, yeah, I sure appreciate y'all giving me the time. And give me a call back if you have any other information you want me to add, or y'all give me any questions. If you got anything else you want to add, go ahead.
Okay, just real quick, let's see. I guess keep us updated if you ever get, I'd try to spread the word, see if we can get some volunteers to get these rocks actually under a LIDAR analysis. Yeah, keep us posted.
Yeah, I believe once we get that done, there's no doubt that this will be proven. So, I mean, it's the last step. And I've been trying to get this last step done for the last 3 years now.
Well, you should be able to find somebody at a geological, you know, any university with a geological, you know, focus. You should be able to find some students there who could.
I've been to every university, sir.
Every university. You're going about it wrong. You're going about it wrong. Don't go through the front door. You need to go on and find these guys that are going to school there and say, hey, you know, you're already there doing this. You know, would this be fun? And because kids do, you know, stuff in their spare time all the time, and they borrow, you know, tools to
do it. I need to let them in on it, though, because I've made that mistake before, and I didn't let them in on what was really going on. And when they contacted people in charge of what the situation, the same people, they were the same people that I first contacted, and those were the wrong people to contact, apparently. There's just a few people in certain positions that have a problem with this. And like you said, if I could get by them, then, yeah, I could get something done, but I'm not sure how they have this much power, to tell you the truth, because this is something that should have been done 4 or 5 years ago. So, I mean,
well, to answer that question, it's called perception management and slave speak. Perception management, slave speak. Go Google.
Yes.
Slave speak was a very good article. I appreciate you sending that to me.
You're welcome. Everybody that's listening and the sound of my voice, go out, Google slave speak. The very first answer will be the anatomy of slave speak. Do not stop till you've done reading it, and you will be an expert bullshit detector.
There you go. Yeah, I took a class on Interact, and that helped me a little bit, but you're right. You got to learn to locate the bullshitters. Sure appreciate it. Yeah, I'll go about it a little bit differently, I believe. And see, like you said, I put the whole hypothesis out there, and I told everybody everything about it, you know, from the start. And innocently thought that my discovery would be accepted, you know. But you're right. And I should have just had people check the rocks in the first place, locally. Like, that's what I had a lot of advice lately, you know, good advice on what I should have done. But now that I'm in this situation right now, and everybody already knows, it's like the cat's out of the bag, and then you know, it's kind of like it really is like the you know, the parable of the trees, you know, or maybe the emperor has no clothes, but I guess it's more like Plato's allegory of the cave, you know. But these people have just been taught this for years, and they got blinders on, and they don't want to accept, you know, the truth.
Are you really surprised? I mean, for thousands of years, people believed the world was flat, and everybody laughed their butt off when they sailed off into the distance. And, you know, they're going to put people like you that, you know, may be ridiculed by some, and then one day you'll have your glorious day in the sun where you get to say, ha-ha, I told you all so. But, you know, people who wait on that are not going to get what they want because they're so busy waiting for validation that they will never achieve what they set out to do. So I would say to you, you know, ignore the haters, take but still have your ears open, because if you've already decided where you're going, you may screw it all up. So keep your ears open, listen to both sides.
I don't want
to
do
it,
yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is important for everybody, you know. So
I do understand the
your speaker brought up a point about changing history. There's a deliberate dumbing down. Iserby's got a great book that talks about all of that and how they're changing our history.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know why they want to.
They just want workers smart enough to do the job and not ask any questions, because with this technology.
Keep the status quo.
Yeah, status quo. Yeah, they, you know.
McDonaldization.
Nobody knows what anybody else is doing. Shoot.
Right after Fukushima, somebody had posted a bunch of information about harmonic resonance, and it was coming from what they were saying was harp at a level of, 2.3, 2.5 megahertz. And that they believe that's what actually created the earthquake along with the tsunami. I found a video done by a scientist overseas, and I did save it, but I didn't put it to external hard drive, and it's no longer on my computer because he confirmed everything that you guys were talking about.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. There's a lot of scientists, I believe, are missing out on magnetic anomalies and electrical reactions between, you know, like I said, the cosmic rays. They're pushing in like waves, you know, like you say on a wake from a boat, maybe, and it pushes in massive amounts towards you know, whatever planet is aligned with them, and that's coming through the atmosphere, you know, like you said, all the muons and whatever, and they affect, you know, vibrations to the crust of plates, and that's what I believe is a lot to do with the earthquakes that happened in, like you said, in 2011, like we had a few comets that were coming in, but I'm not sure, you know, that's just an extra effect. You know, the moon does it all the time, pulls on the tectonic plates, you know, a tidal drift. Right. But
I would really like to step in at this point and clarify something for everybody, because this is the most confused thing in the world. And I'm going to try to do it very quickly. 1958, Project Argus, they started shooting off nuclear missiles into the sky. When that happened, radiation was trapped in the radiation belt. It bounces from pole to pole. That's called the Christofilos effect. This is an anti-satellite weapon used up till today. What happens is these trapped radiation particles bounce from pole to pole. Those are called Whistler waves. When they had Argus, they had Hardtack, they had a couple, like five more upper atmospheric nuclear explosions. Finally, the world stepped in and banned all upper air. I'm being attacked right now. Malware baits blocking IPs. I should read it off, but whatever. You can't stop me now. after they banned all the nuclear explosions in the sky, they wanted to continue their upper atmospheric experimentation. So they started injecting barium and strontium via satellite into the magnetosphere, and the reason why is it's a tracer, so they can see the magnetosphere. If you don't have some dust up there, you can't see it. But they took it a step further, then they started heating it with the Arecibo array heater. So you've got radio waves coming from the Arecibo array heating the barium and strontium and sodium hexafluoride, the world's most dangerous global warming chemical, banned worldwide. They dump it via satellite from the CRES satellite, and heat it with the microwave. Now you flash forward, they say, all right, well, you know, we really want to be able to do this to generate ELF radiation, to be able to talk to our submarines underwater and tell them to surface, because the Clam Lake ELF facility needs to be replaced. It's causing people's brains to hum and killing birds. Clam Lake, Michigan, and or Republic, Michigan, and Clam Lake, Wisconsin, I believe. There's two of them. It's an ELF facility. Go look it up. So they wanted to replace that, and they wanted to make HAARP to do that, and they also wanted to be able to do radiation belt remediation, so pull the radiation that's up there out of the sky because it's frying satellites. So they came up with this thing called the Tether Program, the HAARP Tether Program, and it was HAARP was going to be a wind tunnel to suck radiation belt radiation out of the sky. They shoot a sounding rocket through the sky, burns a hole in the atmosphere, burns a hole in the ionosphere. Holes in heaven, heard that? So the sounding rockets are fired from Poker Flats, Alaska. It burns a hole in the sky. Radiation races down the magnetic field line that rocket just burned a hole in. So there's a magnetic field that's invisible. There's a hole in the sky. The magnetic field line is in the center of that. Radiation from the sky, meaning electrons, come running down from space and cause air glow, which is, you know, false aurora, man-made aurora, let's just put it that way because we did it, and they heat the inside of that area with HAARP, which allows them to bounce radio waves over the horizon and all that. The part they're not telling you is called plasma seeding. Now, plasma seeding is where they detach parts of the ionosphere, which become these resonators. So imagine a bubble outside of our normal bubble that's vibrating. That 2.5 hertz tone that's heard worldwide is created by HAARP. It's created by plasma seeding. They use a combination of rockets, chemicals, and heating from arrays that are worldwide. I have mapped them all out on climateviewer.com. I did it. It took me 2 years. There are probably 14 worldwide that are of substantial, you know, power, and only really about 5 or 6 that can do what HAARP does. And HAARP's the bad one. He's 5.1 gigawatts. For those that don't know what that is, think back to the future. Doc Brown said 1.21 gigawatts. 1.21 gigawatts. That's a lightning bolt. This is 5.1 gigawatts. So that's HAARP. Shooting 5.1 gigawatts into the sky, that's a lightning bolt times 5, if we believe Doc Brown. The one over in Tromsø, Norway, is currently like 1.2 gigawatts, anywhere to like 4 maybe. They're upgrading it to IceCat 3D. By 2016 to 2018, it will be 100 gigawatts.
Gents, I have to jump in.
That's all I got to say about HAARP.
Gentlemen,
you can read all about it on resonated.com.
They're using the northern hemisphere, the upper northern hemisphere to do it, you know, where the atmosphere is low, you know. And so it makes it even work.
Gentlemen?
Go ahead.
I'm sorry, guys. Hello?
Okay.
There was an electrical glitch on the other end, and although we're connected on Skype, we're not connected to the station, so I am recording on my end. The archive will have what you talked about, but I have to end the call now and call the group back. Your callers, if you just give us 2 minutes, you can recall in, but we are not connected to the station right this minute, so I'm going to end the call and call the group back.
She's right.
All right, I sure appreciate it, Jeff.
Okay, everybody, sorry for that glitch. There was an electrical outage on the end of the station, and the radio account Skype went down. I do have a full recording on this end, so the time that you heard silence is recorded and will be available via the archive, usually within 15 minutes after the show, and sometime later tonight or in the morning, I will get this archive to YouTube as well. But, gentlemen, we're back. I'm sorry about that. I don't know how long we weren't live. I'm just kind of seeing in the chat room now, we probably had about 10 minutes there that nobody heard anything.
Wow.
So,
unbelievable.
Yeah. So we are, I'm just getting a message from Jules now. We are back on live. Sorry, again, everybody in the chat room. I am recording this so that I could maybe process it right away to YouTube. And so there will be whatever we talked about that you missed. It will be available. All is not lost. So, and just remember, master of many things is not a fallacy. And if you ever start to wonder that, just go ahead and Google it. But anyway, good stuff, guys. I'm sorry. Hopefully your callers will call back in and rejoin the show. We do have about 18 minutes left. And I'm going to throw you guys under the bus right now. Just because you've done a ton of research, I know you guys, and especially Jim, I've seen you moving around, you know, the internet for a couple of years. You're always at it. You're really putting your best into it. And I think you guys would make a great team for a regular show here at UCY. So I'm going to throw that out. And if you have the same thoughts, get a hold of Jules in your free time, because I think you would just bring so much to the network, and, you know, always solid information. And Tom,
I might be interested in that. Hopefully I'm not attacked every time I talk online.
Drama free, brother. Well, the future is wide open, so there's going to be good opportunities, and we've got good opportunity now to kind of hone it back in, and let's focus on these PMDs, planned mega disasters, and potential threats to the entire world. And, you know, the New Madrid is just so it's such a sensitive topic to so many folks. And when we watched the flooding occur back in 2011 from Canada to the Gulf, and watching those levees get forcibly blown against the governor's demands in Missouri, just extremely strange, these events that go through regardless of what anybody says or does. We don't know what they bombed. Those charges showed up on the Gila quarters there in Memphis. And we've got the Upper Peninsula that's now splitting, and there's earthquakes as far north as Canada. And we know there's stuff going on in the Gulf of Mexico. I wanted to have Mr. B.K. Lim, the expert in disaster capitalism and planned mega disasters, kind of shed some light on that subject, but I couldn't get him to consult. And we're going to focus on comets and celestial bodies. Look, Comet Isis, I'm going to try to find a great article on one that's heading this way. And this refers to history and suppressed history. Why would they cover up all this about the meteor impacting the New Madrid zone there in 1811, causing multiple quakes, which went on for months and triggered the Caracas quake in Venezuela? We have things to worry about. If this information is being hidden, suppressed at all costs, we need to know what's to come and how to deal with it.
Well, yeah, and Thomas, people must get the idea that aside from all the YouTube fear-mongering and all that nonsense, but that something must be going on or about to go on along that zone, because, I mean, they're doing they've done the drills, you know, the terror drills, and we've seen the pictures of the coffins and the underwater body bags and all this other shit. So you don't do those things just for the fun of it, you know? So I don't understand why people don't get the fact that there is something that's going to happen, you know, and that you need to, in some way, at least have the mindset that your entire life could change within a few moments, you know? I don't suggest anybody, you know, get fanatical and just go into full prepper mode and, oh my God, I'm going to die next week or any of that type of stuff. But if you at least have the mindset that maybe you would have to live like we lived 100 years ago in the blink of an eye, I think from that you could do whatever you needed to do. Or could you? I don't know.
I was a Boy Scout, man. I was taught to be prepared. It's pretty simple.
Yeah, and I don't think it really takes enough. A lot. You don't have to get fanatical about it. I mean, you know, having some preparations within your means, you know, but you still have a life to live. I really don't like when I see people kind of sheltering themselves and getting fanatical because they think there's a disaster coming. And we do see those, but I think that's a limited amount of people, and I still, you know, have a hard time with this lying to people or covering up information. It really irks me. And I want to throw out there, Thomas, I had told you, and it's on my website, that when you have, and this applies to anybody, whether you're a YouTuber or a blogger or whatever you do, if you have information that is truthful and it gets removed by the network you're on, by YouTube, by anything else, get in touch with me. I will host that on my website absolutely for free. This is not a catch, and I am the only one that has access to my site. I use a very simple GoDaddy app. I'm not a tech guy, but I will not stand for any censorship. And if anybody is in that situation, because I keep seeing it, people's information is getting removed. Give me the content. I'll put it up there, and nobody's going to take it down unless the government seizes my site, and that'll be the end of it. So then we just buy another domain name. You know, who gives a shit? Because in 24 hours we could have it all back up. You know, but anyway, I thought I'd throw that in there as well. Now, you guys personally, you have all this science, and space is something that I rely on guys like you that understand it, because I don't, and I'm too busy with everything else to learn something new. But with the science that you've seen and the research and the sensitivity of the New Madrid, do you guys in your mind have any approximate time frame that we're going to see major activity in that zone?
No, I mean that.
It's kind of a fool's errand.
If you're asking me, they've measured it the last few years, and it's moved 2 millimeters in the last few years. The fault has moved 2 millimeters. So I don't know if you want to measure that. That's not really tectonic activity. The deal with the New Madrid fault is it doesn't lie on the edge of a plate. It's in the middle of the North American plate, and it just ends on either side. And it just it's just a fault in the middle of nowhere, and it's a weak spot in the plate where its 4 major rivers converge. But they're saying that at one time it encountered the Bermuda hotspot, and when it went over that, it made it weak. But they're trying to say that an ice sheet pulled the land northward, or it was inland seas that came in and caused the design. But if you'll notice, they're all evenly spaced hills, and they're all evenly spaced rolling hills, and they're all the design of a shockwave pattern. So, and all the land is pushed northward toward New Madrid. It just doesn't reverberate out from New Madrid at all. And they just recently found another fault zone called the Big Creek Fault Zone. It's directly beneath the Wolf River, and the Wolf River encircles the first major hill that encircles this site where the structure is. You'll see that it's part of the shockwave pattern that occurred, and there's faults all up and down here. And all this land was loosened just 200 years ago. So I'm not saying that it's not, and I'm not saying it wasn't already a seismic zone either. It could have been already a seismic zone. Like I said, it was a weak spot in the plate, but it's also, it was loosened just 200 years ago, so it could be very active. So anything could happen right here in the embayment, because we've got the Great Lakes right above us, and it floods all the time. And like I said, they need to reroute the Missouri River over to the plains. I don't know why they hadn't tried to do that yet, but anyway, whenever it floods, there's a greater chance of just pushing all this. And the land is settling southward at an exponential rate, which it used to be where you could drive a riverboat up the Loosahatchee River, or the Hatchie River, and now you'd be lucky to get a little bass boat up it when it floods. So it's all closing. That my grandfather said his father and mother used to ride up and down in the riverboat, so...
You're okay with weather modification and geoengineering, obviously, right? I mean, if you're willing to like reroute rivers and stuff, then what the heck? Why don't we just change the weather too, right?
Well, that's what they're doing. They're doing it. So, I mean, if they can do it, why not do it? You know, why not try to take care of people instead of messing everybody up? I don't understand why some of the things they're doing. They're causing more problems than they are fixing anything.
It's all for profit, too. They care not for people. They care only for profit, and there's no oversight.
Well, the profit's going to cost their own children and grandchildren their happiness. They're all profit, so I hope they're greedy. I hope it makes them happy. So.
Well, it's called the Blue Gold Rush, and you're going to worry more about water than earthquakes pretty shortly, trust me.
Absolutely, Jim. That's what our next wars will be fought over. I was warned as a young man to keep an eye on what's going on with the water.
Well, yeah, as long as the ice sheet don't come off of Greenland, we'll probably be all right.
Yeah, water, water everywhere, and not a drop to drink. I mean, if there isn't benzene in the groundwater, there's plenty of other.
Well, that's what's going up. Yeah, sure. That's what I was going with that fracking they're doing just north of here in Arkansas. It's causing minor quakes, you know, and it's been setting off the, you know, moving a fault back and forth. But you know, they set off explosions right above the fault to check for seismic waves, you know, to measure them. So they've done all those. You know,
well, I just dropped a link in chat. Hurricane protection for investors using sea pumps. U.S. patent application 2009-01-77569. This is Ken Caldera, Bill Gates. Oh, my goodness. John Latham, Edward Teller, the father of the H-bomb, Roderick Hyde, Lowell Wood. This is all of the world's geoengineers plus Bill Gates with a hurricane protection system where they, quote, sell protection to investors to reroute hurricanes.
That's just vile and evil.
Go look at it.
Yeah, I don't get an idea, really. The hurricanes have to go into the Gulf to cool the planet. So the Gulf water is the hottest water on the planet, and the hurricanes go up into the Gulf, and they pull that water out. And it's natural circulation, so I don't think that's a good idea to reroute hurricanes. But I don't doubt that they can do it now. You know, like you said, they're too much control and not enough care. And it's getting out of hand. So
well,
it's a bad sign.
For 50 years, they've been saying that they wanted to melt the poles, and then all of a sudden they realize, oh crap, we're melting the poles. Stop melting the poles. Yeah, it's ridiculous. They're doing this thing called geoengineering SRM. They're trying to figure out if they can spray sulfuric acid in the sky and reflect the sunlight. And all the while, you got the weather modification guys cloud seeding like crazy. You got China and Russia. China's got the biggest weather modification budget in the world, and nobody knows what they're doing. And all that floats downwind to us and perturbs the system. So they've modeled what the future is going to look like when they spray sulfuric acid. And I say to Ken Caldera in person on the Google forums, you know, don't you realize you don't have all the variables? Because you don't. You can't. It's a modified system. You don't even understand who's currently modifying it. And now you guys are passing laws to try to modify it globally.
The natural system is already too intricate. Yeah.
Meanwhile, you got Bill Gates and Ken Caldera and John Latham and the boys with a hurricane protection system that says there's a hurricane coming up the Gulf. There's an oil company here. Hey, oil company, your investments are going to be destroyed. I can pump seawater with my silver lining boats and these Atmotion Inc. upwelling pumps. They're straws that suck cold water up to the surface. With these two combined, our geoengineering equipment becomes a hurricane protection system.
Yeah, well, this is asshole as far as I'm concerned. And I try to wake people up, Jim, about the weather modification, because when you go to the Weather Modification, Inc., one of the top consumers in the United States is the Department of Defense. So, you know, even once they the sheep that say, hey, they're spraying the sky, and they convince them that it's fine because we need to help you with the weather, it's not. It's being used to kill people. I mean, why else?
Same as Monsanto with the seeds. Did you hear about what's happening with chili in Mexico just recently?
Well, just to be clear now, you got to understand, there's 100 years of weather modification in America, starting with the Dust Bowl was the big kickoff, and literally farmers begged for cloud seeding. There was martial law declared at that time, too. But it goes right up to the fact that if you live in California, Arizona, or anywhere out there, you should not be there. There is not enough water to sustain the people that live there now. The water that's under your feet is not owned by you. I'm in South Carolina. I can drill a well. I can drink my water. In Arizona, if you do that, you go to jail. Because all of that water is managed down to the drop because they seed the Rockies every single day to keep the ice up there. And if they don't have the ice, you'll all...
What to say, you know, there's too much water over here and not enough over there, you know?
Well, this year is a perfect example. The Mississippi flooded, and I heard it on the news. They say, well, you know, we had an especially thick ice, you know, deposit on the Rockies this year, so it's going to be even more flooding. Well, then I would tell you this. They seed those Rockies every single day to increase the snowfall. Therefore, when the natural flood occurs, damage is done. When all of the extra ice they put up there melts and additional flooding occurs, who's liable for that?
Folks, gentlemen, I just got a message from Jules, and I think you guys will be kind of excited about this. I don't know the host. His name is Dane Winnington, but on Saturdays at 2 p.m. here at UCY, he has a show dedicated to geoengineering. It's called Geoengineering Watch, and I'm just becoming aware of this now, so I want to throw it out there.
Okay?
Appreciate that.
Because this is right up your alley.
Is he okay?
Sounds like Tom has a issue on his end. But I do want to give you just the two-minute warning here. We're down to about 2 or 3 minutes, so if there's anything crucial you need to get out, now's the time. And for anybody that's listening to this through the archives, find me somewhere, and I will be putting all the links that we shared in the chat room tonight. I will put those on the YouTube video archive and on a Pastebin for those of you that don't see it so that the information is everywhere. But just a couple of minutes left, guys.
Okay, I got to go just real quick. I want to say for a future show, perhaps, we could do Blue Gold, The Water Wars.
That's a perfect title, man.
Thank you, Kate.
The Water Wars, man.
Jim Lee.
I sure appreciate all your help.
Yes, Jim. Thank you,
Tony.
All right. Thank you.
Oh, take care. Talk soon.
All right.
Everybody, I was going to say, everybody check out climateviewer.com. You can click network at the end, and that's all my links. I've got 4 websites in there devoted mainly to weather modification, manipulation, and climate engineering. And I've got a 3D map that covers climate pollution and just about everything under the sun.
Thank you, Jim. Thank you. I will be spreading it like wildfire. Many others are going to be supporting you. We got your back, brother. Let's see it just keep growing and keep showing them the truth. So, amen. Rock and roll.
Yeah, and I've got to say, it's a great day because, Jim, and as you know, we've interacted for a couple of years, and this is the first time we've actually been able to sit down and chat publicly. So,
awesome. I've been tweeting this guy for 2 years, everybody.
It's great. I appreciate the support. Much love, everybody. There's the music. I got to go. Next Wednesday, I believe I will have YouTuber Brolance. Him and I will sit down and cover, well, just about everything else that we don't get talked about here on a regular basis. Send your request to me for airtime if your cause needs attention.
Love you, mean it.